Gypsy family and everyone else who may be watching, the word I want to share with you today is from a Psalm of David, the first seven verses of Psalm 39. And it says there, a Psalm of David, I said, I will guard my ways that I may not sin with my tongue. I will guard my mouth with a muzzle, so long as the wicked are in my presence. I was mute and silent. I held my peace to no avail, and my distress grew worse. My heart became hot within me. As I mused, the fire burned. Then I spoke with my tongue, O Lord, make me know my end and what is the measure of my days. Let me know how fleeting I am. Behold, you have made my days a few handbreadths, and my lifetime is as nothing before you. Surely all mankind stands as a mere breath. Selah. Surely a man goes about as a shadow. Surely for nothing they are in turmoil. Man heaps up wealth and does not know who will gather. And now, O Lord, for what do I wait? My hope is in you. Dear friends, the Book of Psalms, or the Prayer Book of Israel, as it's also aptly called, is one of my favorite places to go when I'm unsure where to get guidance and inspiration for my own prayers, or for answers concerning some of the difficult questions of life we're all wrestling with, and where I may find it very difficult to find the right words to bring clarity and comfort in ministering to others. And one of the reasons why I like to turn to the Psalms is that they're brutally honest, whether it's David or Asaph, the sons of Korah, or one of the other original authors, you will always find an unfiltered, accurate account how they felt, of their fears and of their doubts, their joys and their disappointments, and their desperate cries for God's help in times of trouble. And beyond that, they're also inspired by God's Spirit. And you can see that not only in some specific prophetic psalms that were fulfilled in Jesus' life, but also seeing God come through beyond the mere pouring out of emotion and the pleas made that these prayers will be answered. Finally, the psalms are also convicting at times as they confront me with things that are uncomfortable, but very necessary to think about, because they may represent either a blind spot or something I deliberately avoid dealing with. And when we avoid dealing with our dark sides, they will easily grow like a cancer and cause great harm to both ourselves and to others. And the beginning of Psalm 39 is no exception. The very first sentence is like a mirror being held up, because frankly, this is one of the biggest continuing struggles for me, and maybe for you too. Keeping the tongue from sin, watching very carefully when to speak up and when to be quiet. It's so easy to just talk about anything and everything that happens to be on your mind and at any given moment, and particularly when you're angry about something. On the one hand, we see David with a strong resolve to keep his mouth shut, particularly, as it says here, in the presence of the wicked. He seems to know how absolutely useless and even counterproductive it can be to speak truth to people who have no capacity to understand what you're talking about and are likely to just lash out at you and escalate the conflict you have initiated through your words, whether this happens in direct conversation or through the written word in texts or on social media. It seems like David was keenly aware already back then of what Jesus would later describe as casting pearls before swine in Matthew chapter 7. The point Jesus was trying to make was not that it's okay to insult some people by calling them pigs, but that there are some who are completely incapable to do anything useful with the precious truths from God you may feel compelled to share with them. And then there's also James' warning in James chapter 3, where he talks about the tongue as a restless evil and as something no human being can tame. David's intentions, therefore, are all good and honorable, but you can also see how the longer he tries to maintain his silence, how much more difficult it is becoming for him to hold his tongue. And there's yet another danger. Even as you try to limit damage by not saying anything, at the end of verse 2, David remarks that he didn't even say anything good. No, Dad, we're not supposed to remain always silent. We are supposed, for example, to encourage one another. We are supposed to say things that comfort or build each other up. And when we fail to do that, there will certainly be a loss experienced by our silence. And by the way, that also includes being a voice for the voiceless. Whether this is another kid bullied at school or someone else being treated unjustly right in front of us. Throughout the Bible, we find God himself becoming an advocate for those who were defenseless and pushed to the margins, like the poor, the widows, and the orphans. Radical silence on our part does not help them, and even if standing up for their cause means negative repercussions for us, we're still supposed to be vocally on their side, beyond the physical help we may be able to offer. I do understand that in some situations it might be very tricky to say something, either because of the potential to be misunderstood, or because many people nowadays have become hypersensitive and become offended by even the smallest disagreements. The only words of advice I have for these situations is, first of all, ask God for wisdom when you're unsure what to do. Allow the Holy Spirit to give you a proper sense how to proceed. It's definitely better to wait before speaking up too quickly and risking to speak harsh words in the heat of the moment. Well, it will be more likely for your own anger showing through than a more objective challenge to what the other person said or did. What is really interesting here in this psalm is that when David does finally speak, he's still not speaking to his opponents, but he's speaking to God. And what he's saying here is truly remarkable. It's not exactly what you'd expect him to hear him say. Instead, he says, O Lord, make me know my end and what is the measure of my days. Let me know how fleeting I am. In other words, David prays for himself that the Lord would give him a proper perspective concerning the limited length and quickly disappearing nature of his human existence. Life really is so short, and the one lesson that he really wants to take away from his confrontations with the wicked, materialistically minded people is that he would not get sucked into their lifestyle and their way of thinking. He wants to never forget how useless it is to chase after money, recognition, and possessions, no matter how much security or how much of a thrill they seem to offer. It's all about to disappear like a vapor. Our entire lifespan is nothing but a breath. It also quickly disappears, and all the time and energy we've put into chasing certain dreams that were all about ourselves will leave nothing of lasting value. And in the end, it would have all been nothing but a colossal waste of time. So what's the alternative, you may ask? It's all summed up in one short sentence at the end of verse 7. My hope is in you. Let that sink in for a moment. My hope is in you, God. What David is looking for and chasing after are not vain personal goals of success and glory. He's looking exclusively to God to both sustain him in his present troubles and weakness and failings, but also beyond the point of physical death. And I want to encourage you to ponder and meditate on that truth that God is your hope too. God is your hope for all those times where you have said things to someone or even a number of people, and you deeply regret those words today. He's your hope because his love does not end, his patience does not run out, his grace is always greater than our sin. God is your hope while you may be going through a time of grievous, unexpected loss, because he's walking with you through that valley of the shadow of death. God is your hope as your own life may be nearing its end, and you may wonder where all the years went and whether that life made any difference at all. He's your hope because he not only sees the good and hidden things others may have forgotten, but he also leads you into life eternal, never fading away, where every tear will be wiped away. And there's a promise of ultimate healing in God's new will too. We don't need to be paralyzed by the failures of the past, because the one we follow says, I will make all things new. Can you see the difference it makes when you're able to see that God is your hope in every aspect of what you're experiencing right now, and especially in regards to the future he has for you? Maybe there may be someone watching who is saying to himself or herself, I wish I could say or believe that God is my hope too, but I can't. Let me say to you that the belief God invites us into is not something related to the limits of our capacity to imagine what might be true and possible. It is a word spoken, a free invitation given, that like a seed inside your heart has the capacity in itself to create the trust you need in order to be able to respond with a joyful and decisive yes. When God says, my son Jesus died for all your sins and shortcomings, and you can be sure of my forgiveness, and I offer you unconditional grace and eternal life by believing in him, you actually are given the power to accept that incredible gift right here and now. When God says, I know the plans I have for you, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you a hope and a future, you are enabled to believe that this is true and place your future into God's hands. When God's word says that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present or the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation can separate you from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus, you can believe it. You can rely on it as a guarantee that even if you go through the worst of circumstances and experiences, that none of that can destroy you, because God is for you, not against you. His promise stands. It is unshakable. It is underwritten by the blood of Jesus Christ. So there is our victory. There is our hope. It will conquer times of loneliness and isolation. It will be stronger than anything that even the most deadly disease can do to us. It will triumph over every evil. God is my hope. God is your hope too. Let us pray. Lord, we thank you and praise you that we have you in our lives, a hope that is unshakable and undefeatable. May your powerful word create in us anew the faith that can grasp this glorious reality, so that we will not chase after the vain and fleeting things and values so many in our world are still chasing after. Help us also in our continued struggle with taming our tongue. Give us wisdom when we speak up and how, but also when to be quiet and choose not to even try to win an argument. Continue to convict and cleanse us through your word, but also through your own confession and sincere repentance. Wash us clean, purify our thoughts, let us chase after the things that are eternal and unchanging. Comfort the broken and the hurting. Protect us from temptation and danger. And most importantly, give us the ability to cling to you and your salvation at all times. For it is in the precious name of Jesus Christ and according to his will that we pray these things. Amen. Thank you.
that I've been foolish, I've been blind. I've let my doubts and my confusion cloud my mind. I have walked in my own wisdom, I've been wrong. Take me back where I belong. Stripped of all that once I clung to, Lord, I come. Oh, in my arms I know I'm nothing, yet I come. With your hands at once were fenced up just for me. Restore my soul in the valley.